Good morning, TFBC. We are so glad you're with us. Go ahead and stand today. We're going to sing. If you're watching from home, we are glad that you tuned in too today. We want you to worship with us as we sing.
The power of sin and darkness, whose love is mighty and so much stronger, the King of glory, the King above all kings.
Come on, you join me. Here we go.
Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder and leaves us breathless in awe and wonder, the King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You laid down your life. That I would be set free. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King of glory, who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. Lay down your life, and I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. And worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. And worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. Oh, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You laid down your life. That I would be set free. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
All that you've done for me. This is amazing grace. You thankful for that? When the darkness falls, it won't prevail. 'Cause the God I serve knows only how to triumph. My God will never fail. Oh, my God will never fail.
a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. There's power in the mighty name of Jesus. And every war he wages, he will win. I'm not backing down from any giant, 'cause I know how this story ends. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. Take what the enemy meant for evil, and you turn it for good. You turn it for good. You take what the enemy meant for evil, and you turn it for good. You turn it for good. You take what the enemy meant for evil, and you turn it for good. You turn it for good. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. And I'm gonna see a victory. And I'm gonna see a victory, for the battle belongs to you, Lord. You take what the enemy meant for evil, and you turn it for good. You turn it for good. You take what the enemy meant for evil, and you turn it for good. You turn it for good.
You turn it for good. You turn it for good.
Father, we are glad and so thankful that you do that, that you can turn whatever's going on in this world and in our life around. And you make that good. Sometimes we don't understand that or see that coming, but that's who you are, Lord. So help us to realize that. Bless us today as we open our ears. In Jesus' name, amen. We love you. We're glad you're here. Go ahead and have a seat. Good morning, Pastor Mike.
Hey, good morning, everybody. And like Pastor Mark said, we're excited that you're here to worship with us, whether you're in the room, whether you're at home. My name is Mike, and it's my pleasure to serve here at TFBC as a lead pastor. And we are a neighborhood church where anyone can take a next step towards Jesus. We want to be a spiritual home for you to be accepted, to belong to figure out who you are in Jesus and develop into the person that he created you to be so that you can serve, you can have a mission, you can have a purpose here in our church and here in our world. If you're a guest, it's your first time at home with us, here's what to expect. After I'm done, we're going to sing a few more songs. The words will be up on the screen. We'd love for you to follow along with us. And then we're in week two of our series, Winning at Home. Everybody has something that they want us to do, that they want us to listen to, that they want us to care about. But God actually has a good design for us to win where it matters most, with the people that we're closest to, that we have the most influence with. Hey, we're excited. Coming up September 12th, we're going to have a beach baptism and picnic at 4:30 at Carlin Park, Gumbo Limbo Pavilion, across from Carlin Park. And baptism is a next step that we love to celebrate here at TFBC. you've never been baptized before, baptism is the way that we publicly declare to the world that we've made a private commitment to Jesus. And there's no better way to do that in the beautiful, hopefully calm waters of the Atlantic Ocean. So we like to make it a party. So we have food, we have fun, we have games. It's a big, fun family day. So put that on your calendar, September 12th. And if you've never taken that step of baptism, we'd love to have you reach out to us either through texting or the card or talked with us. We'd love to talk with you about how to take that next step towards Jesus. We're also, you're gonna hear in a second, we'd love to just come alongside you. So many of us have so many things going on in our life, so many heavy weights that we're carrying, burdens that we're bearing. And God's plan and good design was for us to have a spiritual family to help us walk through those things. So please reach out, text the number. You have a card right in front of you, you're in the room. Let us know how we can pray for you. We pray every single week for all of those requests that come in. We want to walk alongside you, help you live the life that you're in right now. Well, school started this week. People are going back to college. It's a really difficult time to be in school and to be an educator. So we wanted to take today just to pray over all of our educators, all of our teachers, all of our administrators, all of our principals, all of our students, everybody that's traveling back to wherever they go for college, to help them have the greatest start to the school year. Hopefully you've not been kicked out or expelled this week. So let's pray that from here on out, God helps you to survive, sustain where you are. So let's just take a moment, dedicate the time we have together just to pray for our kids, pray for our teachers, pray for all of our neighborhood schools who are trying to do their best to educate our neighborhood kids. So let's pray. Lord Jesus, we're grateful that you've created us with this desire and capacity to grow and to learn. And you said in Genesis to take dominion of the earth and to explore and to figure out who you are and how you've wired the universe, how you've wired us. And Jesus, we live in a difficult day for our schools and our teachers and dealing with COVID and dealing with the years past of online stuff and just masking, all this craziness going on. And they're just trying to do their job, God, to teach and develop our students. And so we pray over all of our teachers in our congregation as they're out on mission in public schools and private schools and leading and counseling and teaching and coaching. Jesus, I pray that you give them an extra measure of your grace. Help them to be your ambassador. Help them to be a safe and calm person in the classroom, as many of the students in our neighborhood don't have that at home. And Jesus, I pray for the students of our church as they go back to school, as they go back to college, that you would help them just to walk in your design, to make good decisions, to make good friends, to be on mission, to grow and to learn. And Jesus, I pray that you'd use our church and use the people of our church, God, to help point people to you. Jesus, we're grateful that we live in a neighborhood that has neighborhood schools, and we pray specifically for all of those neighborhood schools, that you'd help them to succeed and to win, and help us to keep finding opportunities to walk alongside our teachers and our educators as they try to do their job for you. And it's in your name, Jesus, that we pray. Amen.
Good morning, TFBC. We are excited and grateful to be able to worship with you this morning. Hey, if this is your first time joining us in person, or if you found us and you're watching us online for the first time, we are especially excited that you are joining us. And we would love to be able to connect with you and get the privilege to know more about you. And you can do this in a couple of different ways. You can connect with us right now by pulling out your phone, and you can text the keyword TFBC to the number that you currently see on the screen right now to fill out an online connection card. Or if you're in person with us this morning, you can reach directly into the pew in front of you and you can pull out a connect card here. We would love for you to fill these out, and you can turn them into the guest services area, which is located by the east entrance of our church building. And we have a free gift that you can take home this morning there. We are so excited for all that God is doing here at TFBC through all of the different areas of ministry through our church. And these ministry areas are kept alive and running by your giving, and we are extremely grateful for that. And there's a couple of different ways that you can give. You can go to our website at www.tequestaschurch.net, and you can click the Give tab at the top of the homepage there to give online, or you can give in person this morning through either of the offering boxes that are located at either entrance of our church building. Hey, just a reminder that Grief Share is continuing its normal meetings every Tuesday from 6:30 to 8:30 in the former choir room. Also, if you're not connected with a small group at all, we would love for you to visit our website again at tequestaschurch.net. You can go to the top of the homepage and you can click the Groups tab, which will drop down, and you can click Small Groups to view a list of a variety of small groups. You can click the Reply button so that we can be able to get you plugged in to these small groups so that you don't have to do life alone and that you can get plugged in to the awesome community that we have here at TFBC. Also, students, don't forget that our fall meeting is coming up so soon. We're going to be meeting on Sunday nights again at 5 p.m. for the first time on August 29th. So mark your calendars, and we can't wait to see you that Sunday night. TFBC, again, we are so excited that we can be able to worship together this morning. Let's stand up right now and let's continue to worship our Lord together.
Go on, you heard Noah. Ready? God of the promise, God of the future, you see beginning and end. God of the rescue, God of the breakthrough, how great is your faithfulness. You're not done yet. No eye has ever seen, no ear has ever heard, no one could ever comprehend. Your word will be enough, your promise we will trust. Greater things are still ahead. You're not done yet. You're not done yet. God in my seeking, God in my dreaming, put a song in my soul. God in the working, God, I'm believing, you do the impossible. You're not done yet. No eye has ever seen, no ear has ever heard, no one could ever comprehend. Word will be enough, your promise we will trust. Greater things are still ahead. You're not done yet. You're not done yet. You're not done yet. You're not done yet. You're up to something right now. Doing a new thing right now. God, let your glory come down. Don't hold back, don't hold back. You're up to something right now. You're doing a new thing right now. God, let your glory come down. Don't hold back, don't hold back. You're breaking chains right now, right now. God, let your glory come down. Don't hold back, don't hold back. No eye has ever seen, no ear has ever heard, no one could ever comprehend. Your word will be enough, your promise we will trust. Greater things are still ahead. Done with your family. It's not done with this church. He's not done with this country.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. For the Lord God Almighty reigns. You know this song. Sing it with me.
Resurrected me.
the King of Kings.
Father, thank you for turning our hearts to you. We pray that they are open right now for Pastor Mike's word. We give you all the praise in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated.
So right after church too, to celebrate being back in school, on your way out here at our welcome tent, we're going to have some popsicles for everybody. You don't just have to be a student. Go snag a popsicle right after church. We'd love to hang out with you. So we're in this series, Win at Home, week two. And like I said, there's so much happening around us. There are so many people trying to grab our cheeks, trying to get us to pay attention to what they want us to pay attention to, care about what they care about, get involved with what they want us to get involved with. But I don't think that's God's good design for us. God wants us to be locked in the places where he's given us the most influence, with our family, with our friends, in our neighborhood. And so today, let's jump right into God's word. Let's get started. Ephesians, Paul's book to the Ephesians, Chapter 4, so fire up your Bible app, turn in your Bible, check out the screen, Ephesians chapter 4. I'm just going to read two verses, verses 31 and 32. Paul says this: "Let all bitterness and wrath and anger and clamor and slander be put away from you. Let it go. Let all that go, along with all malice. But be kind to one another, tenderhearted, forgiving one another as God in Christ forgave you." Stop right there. All right, you may have heard the story of How to Catch a Monkey. Now, a few disclaimers. I'm not sure if this is true because it's on the internet. I'm not sure why you would ever want to catch a monkey, and I'm pretty sure it's illegal in like every country to catch a monkey. But because this story shows my sermon point so well, I'm going to use it. All right, so if you want to catch a monkey, let's just say, hey, I want to catch a monkey. Here's what you do. You find a jar, and you put food in it that so-called species of monkey wants to eat, like rice or a banana or a gourd. And the trick is that you get a container or jar that's small enough that the monkey can put its hand in flat and grab the food, but the container is too small for the monkey to pull his hand out when he's grasping the food. Now, here's what the internet says. Now, the monkey's highest priority is getting food, right? So the monkey walks up and he's like, man, these humans are suckers, right? Man, they just leave food lying around. I'm going to snag some of this food. So he tries to snag that food, but we humans are crafty, right? And because the monkey's highest priority is food, he doesn't know that he can get food somewhere else. He doesn't care that he can get food somewhere else. He trades, according to the internet, he trades his freedom for food. Now let's bring that over to Ephesians. And what a picture it is of us, of me, when I hang on to bitterness, when I hang on to anger, when I hang on to unforgiveness. We hold on so tight. God says, let go of that, cling to me. But we think, oh, if I let go, if I let go of that bitterness, if I let go of that anger, if I let go of that situation and forgive, well, who's going to look out for me, right? Who's going to take care of me? The other person is getting off the hook, right? Who's going to make sure, if I let go, who's going to make sure that justice is served? But all the while we hold on to that unforgiveness, that bitterness, we put ourselves in a prison. In a prison of anger. In a prison of bitterness that's so caustic that it has the potential to not only burn through us and poison us, but to burn through all the relationships of those that we hold dear. Here's the main truth. Here's the main idea that I have for you today. That if you go home, I pray that if you remember anything, I pray that you remember this. What we cling to controls us. What we hold on to controls the direction of our life and our heart. And so we have the choice, thankfully. Are we going to cling to bitterness and be in a prison, or are we going to cling to Christ in a way that He controls our heart and our life? And to hammer home that main point, I have three main truths here. Here's the first truth. Clinging to bitterness, it poisons you, and it poisons all of those around you. The reason that Paul says, put that stuff away. He's looking out for you. He's looking out for those around you, because bitterness is caustic. It's poison. The author of Hebrews says, be careful. Watch out that you don't hold on to that unforgiveness and bitterness so that it causes a bitter root to grow up in your heart and your life and start to affect and poison and reach its tentacles all around you. Paul says in 2 Corinthians that we should be very careful and avoid unforgiveness and bitterness, because it's one of the main schemes of the evil one, of Satan, to come in and control us and control our relationships. Bitterness is a huge temptation for all of us. For me, for you, and it's because all of us get hurt, right? We live in a fallen world. We are broken sinners. And in a family and at work and at school and at church, people will hurt you, right? There's pain. We can't avoid it. I wish I could bubble wrap all of my kids up, right? Keep them all safe, keep them away from pain. Literally this week, I almost had to go have a word with a first grade little boy, right? Because he's causing pain. I want to stop that. But we can't. We can't protect ourselves. And when we're hurt, this temptation of bitterness and unforgiveness that we want to cling to rises up. The word in Ephesians there for bitterness, it comes out, it's this anger, this specific anger that originates because we're hurt. It's this gnawing hostility in us. Someone has described bitterness as an atmosphere produced in us when we meditate over our life circumstances and we decide we haven't been given a fair deal. Someone else said that bitterness is this hidden hurt that we've tucked away in our heart. Someone did us wrong. Someone said something about us. Someone hurt us. Someone disrespected you. Someone was inconsiderate of your feelings. Someone left you out. Someone took advantage of you. Someone abandoned you. Someone abused you. Or maybe, just maybe, you feel passed over in life. It feels like everybody else is living their best life, but then there's just you over there, right? Or maybe in your relationships and your life, it, it feels like it's been a death by a thousand cuts, a thousand little hurts you've never really dealt with, you're holding on to. And now this root of bitterness, this caustic poison is growing and taking over not only your life and relationships, but those around you. And as we cling to it, as we hold on to it, what do you know? The person that we're bitter towards, they start to take up residence in your mind, right? Ever been in a conversation in the shower with somebody that's not there, right? You're telling them off. Like, they're in your mind. Like, you should start charging them rent by how much mental space they've taken up in your mind. One author said, the man I'm bitter towards, he hounds me everywhere I go. I cannot escape his tyrannical grasp on my mind. He may be hundreds of miles away, but he's a slave master to me. Man, when we're bitter too, doctors tell us it can cause so much problems in our physical body. It doesn't matter though, we like to cling to it. We want to hold on to it, because if we don't, who will? Who will make sure that they get what they deserve? Who's going to do something with this pain, this hurt that I have in my heart? And so we think, well, I'll just hold on to it. I'll just keep stewing. And all the while, that underlying boil and deterioration keeps gnawing away at our spirit and at our relationships. And so Paul says, put that stuff away. Get rid of it. Don't cling to it. Don't keep trying to take out and shove out your bitter fist from the jar. Heard a story of this guy before there were treatments for rabies. He was bit by a rabid animal and came in, and the doctor's like, hey, you know what? This is what it is. You have rabies. I'm really sorry. Like, you should prepare yourself. You should prepare mentally, spiritually. And so the guy's like, oh, he starts writing a big list down, and the doctor's like, oh, maybe, you know, he's taking my advice seriously. Maybe he's writing a will. Maybe he's writing a love letter to his family. So the doctor asks him, hey, what are you doing? Are you writing like a list to your family? Are you writing like a last words to your family? He's like, I'm not writing a love letter. I'm writing a list of people that I want to bite before I die to spread this rabies everywhere. And that's funny and weird, but the truth is, when we're bitter, that's exactly where we are. That's where I am. We want to get them. We're going to make them pay. And so we think the way to heal ourselves is to hurt other people, but we end up destroying ourselves and those around us in the process. So how do we let go? What's the antidote to bitterness? How do we release ourselves from that trap? And the answer is our second principle, clinging to forgiveness. Clinging to forgiveness frees us from bitterness. Paul in Romans 12 says, cling to what is good. Grab hold of what is good. Look back with me, Ephesians 4. Paul says, let all bitterness and wrath and anger and clamor and slander be put away from you. Let go of that, along with malice. But hold on to kindness. Be kind to one another. Be tenderhearted, forgiving one another as God in Christ forgave you. Cling to forgiveness. It frees us from bitterness. But forgiveness is hard, right? And I think many times we struggle with forgiveness because we actually don't have a concept of what real biblical forgiveness is, right? Human to human. We understand what God's forgiveness is many times, right? God has a different view of forgiveness. God has an unconditional forgiveness. And actually, God's forgiveness powers our human to human forgiveness. But forgiveness is a little bit different. Here's what forgiveness is. One author said that forgiveness is surrendering the right to get even. or to hurt the other person in response to what they did to you. Forgiveness is refusing to retaliate. Forgiveness is letting go of that bitterness, that feeling to get back for what they've done to us. Forgiveness is actually not about the other person. Forgiveness is about you. Forgiveness is about what's going on in your heart. And forgiveness is not dependent on the other person at all. Whether they apologize, whether they're repentant, whether they even care or know that they hurt you, you can grab hold of a forgiveness that frees you from the toxicity of bitterness. Here's what forgiveness isn't, by the way. Forgiveness isn't saying that it doesn't matter. The hurt doesn't matter. The pain doesn't matter. Forgiveness isn't saying, oh, it's all good, when it isn't. It isn't actually denying even that the other person is wrong. It isn't minimizing what they did to you. And forgiveness doesn't actually mean that the relationship is going to go back to normal, to go back to the way it was before. It may not. It may. Forgiveness may be the avenue and vehicle that God uses to restore and reconcile. But reconciliation and restoration is a two-way street. And forgiveness frees you and your heart from being in prison to what this other person has done for you. And forgiveness doesn't mean that these people get to do whatever they want and that they don't have consequences for what has happened to you. Forgiveness, it frees us. It frees us from the bondage of bitterness, from having our hand in the jar, having that poison infiltrate our heart. And forgiveness is a process. It doesn't just happen overnight. You have to consciously decide to forgive, but it's something that we have to keep revisiting. We have to keep handing over. We have to keep grabbing hold of. Because real forgiveness, the way that God thinks about forgiveness for us to each other, is this. It actually requires clinging to God. That's my last truth for us today. Clinging to God, not bitterness, actually frees us and gives us the power to have real forgiveness in our heart and mind. Paul said this in Romans 12, thinking about hurts and persecutions and the things we face. He says, blessed, and this is crazy talk, for this is only powered by God himself could do this. Okay, so listen up. Paul says, blessed those who persecute you. What? Like, really? Blessed those who persecute you. Bless and do not curse them. Rejoice with those who rejoice. Weep with those who weep. Live in harmony with each other. Do not be haughty, but associate with the lowly. Never be wise in your own sight. Repay no one evil for evil, but give thought to it and do what's honorable in the sight of all. If possible, so far as it depends on you, live peaceably with all. Beloved, never avenge yourselves, but leave it. Hand it over, Paul says, to the wrath of God, for it is written, God says, vengeance is mine. God says, I will repay, says the Lord. The contrary, if your enemy is hungry, feed him. If he is thirsty, give him something to drink, for by doing so, you will heap burning coals on his head. Do not be overcome by evil. Don't grab hold of that evil. Paul says, don't cling to the evil, but overcome evil with good. Overcome bitterness by clinging to Christ. The truth is, real forgiveness, the forgiveness that frees you and me from that bondage and slavery of the mental gymnastics that we play with the people that have hurt us, the real forgiveness only comes from handing the situation over to God, but also handing that person that hurt you over to God. It's not a fairy tale pretending everything's cool and no problem. We can forgive, Paul says, because we can be assured that God is always watching. And that God, Here's a really, okay, so this statement, it really comforts me when it's about other people. It really scares me when it's about me. We will have to give an account for everything that we do. Sounds really good, right? When it's about other people, like, oh yeah, they're going to get it. But then I remember, oh wait, like, I'm going to have my turn too. And so really the heart of forgiveness, in a way, you can't conjure it up. It actually is trusting God. It's actually clinging to God and saying, God, here they are. I know you're watching. I know you care. I know you know what's going on in my heart. Here is the situation. Paul says we can forgive, verse 32, because Christ gave his very life for us to have forgiveness. And forgiveness, obviously, between us and God. But also in Ephesians 2, Paul says that Christ died to take away the hostility between each other, to break down the walls of bitterness that existed between people. Now in Ephesians 2 is different issues that we're facing now, but the fact remains. Jesus Christ came, lived, and died, and was raised from the dead so that I could forgive you and you could forgive me. That same power is available to let us go from the pain and poison of bitterness. It's so easy to let walls linger, right? That's what's easy. That's what's natural. And in relationships, any relationship, in a family, with friends, in a church, walls at school, at work, walls come up, right? We say careless words. We have a chronic neglect, maybe of each other's needs. You have a latent selfishness that just kind of keeps playing itself out. And then before you know it, we're living in this low-grade bitterness with our family, with our friends. You know, in our world, it's been supremely disappointing to see how people are treating each other, right? How people are talking about each other, even in the body of Christ. I'm not talking about our church, but just like the world Christianity, maybe American Christianity. Man, we're divided over things that should never divide family. And we're treating, I say we, I don't mean like our church, I mean like we, like Christians. Christians are treating each other terribly. And we're speaking to each other in anger. And we are acting like jerks because we believe that our cause or our issue is that important. But Paul says, hey guys, as the people of Christ, remember the people who Christ has died for and who has revealed himself to, you guys got to be different. And the only way to be different is to let go of the bitterness and to grab on to Christ's power. And what's crazy, as we grab on to Christ's power, what happens is our family, our friend group, our school, our church, it becomes this ecosystem and petri dish that's conducive to all of us taking a next step together because we're people who hurt each other, but then through Christ's power, we practice forgiveness by letting go of it and grabbing hold of Christ. Bitterness is a real and present danger for all of us every day. If you know some people, bitterness is a real and present danger. As you read through the New Testament, Jesus interacts and uses stories and parables to talk about forgiveness and the importance of forgiveness. And there's this one story that's a jaw dropper. You may have heard this story from the New Testament. Jesus, he uses these extremes to highlight a main truth or a main point. And there's this guy that owes this super rich guy 20 years' wages. So like if the average, 20 years' salary, this guy owes this rich guy. And so the rich guy's like, hey, come on, man. Like, I need my money. You've had enough time. And the guy goes to me, falls down. He's like, please, please forgive me. Like, I don't have it. I'll do anything. Like, I'll work it off. Like, I'll give you interest, whatever. Like, I'll give you my, whatever. Help me, please. Don't throw me in debtor's prison. And the guy's like, all right, I'll forgive you. I'll let you work it off. So right after the dude walks out of being with the super rich guy, he walks up to this other guy in the street. He's like, who owes the guy one day's salary. Like one day. One day. This guy owes 20 years salary, and this other guy owes him one day. And the guy's like, hey, where's my money? I want my one day's salary. And the guy's like, hey, I don't have it. Like, I'll get it to you. He's like, no, 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 you're not doing that. You don't have time. Get in prison. Get in debtor's prison because you owe me a day's salary. Well, what the guy doesn't know is that the super rich guy has some eyes on the street, and he sees what happens. So he calls the guy in. He's like, what's going on, man? Like, you owe me 20 years wages, and you let this guy off the, you put this guy in prison for one day? Get your person in jail. Get in jail. Like, you're going to, sorry, this is self-edited there. Get in jail right now. Now, the moral of the story Jesus wants us to know is that we owe each other one day's wages. We owe God 20 years' wages. God forgives us so much. But a second, and that's amazing, a secondary truth is when we don't forgive each other, where do we end up? In jail, in prison, just trying to work and work and work and trying to forgive, all the while letting forgiveness lock us up. Today, you can let go. Today, God says, you can trust me. Today, you can cling to Christ and let go of that hurt. That person, that situation, doesn't have to be your master anymore. And so today, what do you need to do? Start that process. Do you need to get on the phone? Do you need to get on FaceTime? Have a conversation about forgiveness? Do you need to talk with us at our Next Step Center over here to help us come alongside you to process the hurt that you've been through, to just get the ball rolling forward, to let your hands start to undo their vice grip on the hurt that you have? We'd love to talk with you. What you cling to will control you. Let's not cling to bitterness. Let's cling to Christ. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we're so grateful that you've forgiven us so much. While we were far from you, while we were rebelling against you, while we were doing it our own way, and your enemy, you say, you died for us, and your power is available to connect us back to you. And maybe that's you today. You are not reconciled with your Heavenly Father. You're here today. You want to be. You're not really sure how, but you're not really forgiven. You're not living in that freedom of the forgiveness that God has given you through his son Jesus. And today, we'd love to talk with you. We're going to be right outside, go to the Next Step Center, about how you can start a relationship with Jesus by chasing after his design, by banking your life on his way and not your way. And Jesus, I know all of us in here, because we're in relationships, we're in families, we have friends, we've all been hurt, and we have a temptation to hold on to it and let it grow and let it become a beast and let it control our mind and our soul and our spirit. Jesus, I pray through the power that rolled away the stone and brought you back to life that you would help us to let go of the hurt and the situations that have us in prison. And Jesus, you are the good master. You said that your load is easy. Your burden is light. Help us to cling to you. And as we cling to you, you supernaturally begin to heal the hurts that are in our heart. And we can trust that you are a just God, and that you're watching, and that you're taking care of us. We love you, Jesus. Help us to be a family, a spiritual family. Help our families, help our friend groups to be a place where forgiveness is a culture and there's an ecosystem of it, God, so that we can live unhindered and free from the effects of bitterness and anger. And it's in your name, Jesus, that we pray. Amen.
Okay, would you stand with us as we sing, as we go? We're singing about how marvelous, how wonderful God's love is for us.
I stand amazed in the presence of Jesus the Nazarene, and wonder how he could love sinner condemned, unclean, singing how marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be, how marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me. He took my sins and my sorrows, made them his very own. He bore my burden to Calvary and suffered and died alone, singing out. And with the ransom in glory, his face I at last shall see. 'Twill be my joy through the ages to sing of his love for me.
True that song is and how deep that love is, but we believe it, and someday we're going to see that in person and feel that and have that for people around us. Lord, we love you. We look forward to that day when we spend eternity with you. There's one here that does not know you, has not given their life and surrendered to you. I pray that today is that day in their heart and their life. Draw them to yourself, Lord. We love you. We look forward to what you have for us this week. Send us out on a job and a mission in Jesus' name. Amen. All right. Lord bless you. You are dismissed.
Came to you.